This is Ann-Kathrin Koch. We've worked with her for years, and I've been a fan of her work, but because she's in Europe, never met face-to-face until, when was it, Thursday?
Wednesday, I think.
Okay. Yeah. The days are all jumbled together. Yeah. So it was great. So welcome. Let me give a little bit of an intro. Okay, born in Germany, now lives in England. Mainly shoots destination weddings. Now, this is super interesting, and I'll get into this question. Before she was a photographer, she was an editor for movies. Wow, that's super interesting. Featured on blogs like Style Me Pretty, Wedding Sparrow, Junebug, Snippet, and Ink. What's your story?
So, my story. I guess we can start, like you said, about the film editing that I used to do before. So, I was a film editor mainly for advertising and music videos, and then TV and movies afterwards. And I spent about 13 years doing that, and I was sat in a dark room with three computer monitors in front of me.
Okay.
With people coming back from the most exotic locations, like shooting in Cape Town, shooting in Argentina, and they were like, oh, the steaks were amazing in that restaurant we went to in Chile. And like, here's all the footage. Have fun for 5 days in the basement with no windows, editing all this stuff.
So they would go to the destinations and they'd
exactly.
make you edit.
Like, wow. They shoot all the stuff and I come in and look at all the beautiful stuff and have to edit it. And I guess I just got a little bit tired of looking at beautiful footage and not having a chance to do any of that myself. So I've always been taking photos for myself. And then I worked as an assistant for a commercial photographer for a few months in a studio and realized that what he was doing was exactly what I did not want to do with photography, which is fulfilling someone else's creative brief and just pressing the button
okay.
and cashing the check. So, I mean, I did like the cashing the check
sure,
bit.
Sure, we all do.
But not the rest of it. So I kept on editing until friends of my brother, I think it's a typical story, got married and they asked me to take some pictures because they saw my pictures. And I said, no, I do not want to take pictures at weddings.
Jose mentioned that his first wedding, I believe he charged $400 for.
I charged 700 euros.
Okay.
So that's better than that.
Did you lose money?
I didn't lose any money on that one because I shot it all on digital
okay.
at the time. But, I did shoot 4 rolls of film
okay.
for the portraits. But I just based it on my day rate as a film editor because I had no idea what I was going to do and that I would spend 2 weeks editing all the pictures afterwards. But I did notice that it's a lot more fun working with people who are having the happiest day of their life and who afterwards may cry from joy looking at their pictures rather than a room full of advertising executives who hate everything that you've done and tell you that it's not good enough, but they don't know why.
Okay.
So that was kind of like the point where I decided, okay, I rather want to do this and do something for the soul. That's pretty nice to do. Make people happy with it. And you can actually make money with that too if you do it smartly.
That's great.
Yeah.
So you mentioned you had, you'd always taken photos and were a photographer. Did you have any formal training?
No, not on the photography side.
Oh, so just self-taught, huh?
Yeah.
Were you, when you started out shooting for yourself and for fun, were you shooting film or mainly digital?
Yeah, I was shooting film at that point. I think it's because I've always been really interested in art and photography, like looking at it. And every time I found photographers or photographs that I really liked, they were all shot on film. So I figured I'm going to do something about this and also start shooting film. So I bought a Hasselblad. A 500 cm, the nice square one,
okay.
on eBay. And the day I bought that camera, I put my digital camera in the cupboard and didn't touch it for like 2 years.
Wow.
And it was a very steep learning curve shooting on that Hasselblad because it takes like 2 weeks until you see the film. So you have no idea what you actually did when you shot that roll until I started writing down my settings. Like, how did I expose this shot? And why is it murky and gray and horrible looking? So, so I started shooting everything on film that I did just for myself. And then kind of progressed from there.
So, you shoot tons of travel destination weddings. Question, how do you book travel jobs when you are not in that location? Like, where do your bookings come from?
Okay, so... I think it's the same story as with everything that you do. If you want to shoot something, you have to show that you can shoot that.
That's kind of a common theme. I heard Jose mention that
exactly.
several times.
So I think with destinations specifically, it's really important that your clients trust you. So if you bring somebody in to a faraway location when you could as well probably book somebody who lives there and who's not as expensive, there needs to be a really good reason why they want to book you. So my experience is that if you can show people that you know what you're doing, you know how to get there, you know what you're doing when you get there, and that it's going to be safe to trust you with all this money and fly you to this place, and you're still going to do a really, really great job, probably a better job than the person who's local, then that's how that's going to happen. So if you haven't shot a destination wedding before, then you can't show one, but you can always show other things that are related to this. You can travel somewhere and take travel pictures and show those, or just like start from there, basically.
When you started shooting the destination weddings, was this always like a goal of yours? Like you wanted to shoot destination weddings, or it's something that just kind of happened?
No, that's definitely something that just kind of happened. So I was shooting mainly in England at the time because I'm based in England and it's very dark in England so all year round. So it's not that much fun to shoot film.
A little bit brighter than in the US right
exactly.
now.
Exactly. So. Just for maybe, yeah. Not really. So it's not a lot of fun to shoot film over there. So, but also it's a lot easier, I think, in Europe to be shooting destination weddings because there's a lot of weddings happening in Italy or France with English clients going over there to get married, which probably is similar to here, people getting married in Hawaii or Mexico or something
sure.
like this, or anywhere with palm trees, mm-hmm. which you have a lot more of
we do.
Than we do. So it wasn't really a goal. It was more something that kind of happened organically. And that's actually another point of how to start shooting destination weddings. It's you have to ask for it. You kind of have to put it out there. So in my case, it was actually a couple from Malaysia that had booked me for a engagement shoot, like the typical whole day, 8 hour, five different dresses, hair and makeup woman with us all day long kind of engagement shoot in Munich at the time. And we got on so well that I thought, like, after I gave them the images, I'm just going to send them an email and say, hey, guys, if you haven't got a photographer yet for your wedding in Malaysia, just to let you know, I'd love to come out and shoot your wedding for you. And it took like 20 minutes until she emailed back and
wow.
said, it took so long for me to reply because I was busy screaming because that was exactly what I was going to say to you. It would be fantastic if you could come out and shoot our wedding.
Oh, that's great.
And that was just kind of what I was like. People don't know necessarily that you're able to fly out somewhere and do stuff somewhere else. Like they think we need to look for a local photographer. We need to take whatever's offered from the hotel that we booked the wedding with.
Sure.
They don't know. So you can't sit there and wait for people to come to you. You got to put it out there.
Now, at this point, were you still doing the film editing or had you jumped full into the photography?
At that point, I was full-time photography.
Okay.
Yeah.
Was that a hard leap?
It was not so hard for me because I was freelancing doing the film editing. So I was much more flexible, kind of like taking on weddings on weekends and then not doing any editing because the editing work was very short notice. It was like, are you free tomorrow for 5 days? And obviously weddings book months and years in advance. So it was much easier than quitting a 9-to-5 job and kind of like slowly transitioning into it. And I kind of did it at the whole time, basically keeping my prices at a pretty high level already because I didn't want to start out doing the super cheap weddings and then spending years and years building it up.
Sure.
I wanted to kind of, because I could afford to, because I was still doing the editing, I could afford to kind of like say, no, I'm charging this much money and I'm only booking 6 weddings or whatever a year and then slowly build it up from there. And it actually, I think my first full year, I shot 21 weddings. So it was still working.
Yeah. How many? So how long have you been doing it? How many years?
I went full time in 2012.
Okay.
So
this will be your 5th year.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you learned editing, you know, TV, movies and stuff that helped you with the photography?
Yeah, definitely. I think it really, like, you learn from the best almost when it comes to composition, lighting, everything else. Because especially doing the advertising and the movie stuff, these are really, really great cinematographers doing that kind of work. And you spend looking at all of their footage, everything that they shoot. And you're the one determining which of this stuff is good and it's going to make it into the actual edit. So you spend judging every single frame and deciding this is good or this is bad and why is this bad and why does this work and this one doesn't. So I think it really helped me figure out what I like composition-wise, styling-wise, everything to do with it. I think it really taught me to have an eye for a certain image without spending the time shooting myself necessarily, if that makes any sense.
Sure.
Yeah.
It makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
How do you balance family life with all the traveling you're doing? How many weddings did you shoot last year? Destination weddings did you shoot last year?
Destination weddings last year, probably 12, I want to say.
Okay.
So, and most of them were like really like long haul flight kind of destination weddings. So when I do a wedding that's that far away, I usually try and stay longer if I can, because you don't want to fly 15 hours and then fly back the next day.
Sure.
If you can avoid it.
Yeah, of course.
So for me, it's like I don't have a family. Well, I have parents and
sure,
stuff,
sure.
But I don't have any
kids.
I'm not married. So that's a bit easier, I think. I think the only way you can balance it is if you have the right priorities. So you got to decide beforehand, how much time do I want to spend with my family, or how much time do I have to spend with my family, and how much can I afford to be away? So if you have a family at home with small children or whatever, you probably cannot go on like a 2-week holiday every time you book a destination wedding, unless you can take them with you. If you have that flexibility, I think that's a great idea to try and make it into a family vacation, or take your significant other as an assistant or something like that. That would always work. But yeah, you just got to decide for yourself beforehand how much time can afford to be away, and then you got to stick with it. And then also spend the time that you're away traveling. It's work time. Like you cannot, like I work on the plane. I work in the lounge at the airport, whatever, if I have to, because that way I'm free when I'm back home. Because if you travel for a whole week, you come back home and you've got only like 5 days with your family and you have to spend those 5 days working, then that's not great. So yeah, priorities, I think.
How early are you arriving to a destination wedding? I'm imagining it's not the day of.
It's not the day. It's never the day of. It's usually the day before, or even 2 days before, depending on how far away it is. So that's the one reason is you don't want to be late. And there's like volcanic ash clouds or whatever that keep you from flying out. So you want to make sure you get that flight there in time. And the other reason is also location scouting, like having a look beforehand.
That.
Yeah. And it's most of the time, it's also the first time I meet the couple, because they all live somewhere else. Like all of my clients live completely somewhere else than I do. So I never meet them beforehand. I Skype with them, but I don't meet them personally. So it's a good time to do that beforehand.
How do you prepare for the different locations? And what I mean by that is, you know, the light, the limitations from customs, flying with film, that sort of stuff.
Okay, so when it comes to the light and the locations, Google Maps is your friend. Street View, Google Street View has changed my life a lot.
Google Street View is kind of freaky, actually.
Because if it looks halfway decent on Google Street View, it's going to look amazing in person. You know that.
Yeah.
It usually looks pretty crappy on there. So I literally, like, I go on Google and I find out, what time is sunrise, what time is sunset, what are the locations close to the venue. Then I Google image everything, like, is there any really, really cool places that are close by that we can go to? So I try and research everything as much as I can beforehand. Stuff with sunrise and sunset, for example, if you're in a tropical location, you got to be aware that the sunset takes 20 minutes. And not like 3 hours of golden, beautiful sunset light, but it's 20 minutes and then it's dark. And you're like, oh, I didn't realize it was going to be this quick. So maybe
what
we should have done these photos an hour ago. So it's all this kind of stuff. You just got to prepare as much as you can when it comes to the locations. And then I fly out early to make sure that I have some time to walk around, have a look around and see if there's anything I want to shoot. Ideally at the same time as it's going to be the next day, like same time of day, to make sure the light is very similar.
So there's quite a bit of pre-production that goes into putting this together. If you had to estimate, what's the pre-production time on a wedding?
So it's definitely different from a destination wedding to a local wedding.
Sure.
And I want to say with destination weddings, I spend probably about like 16 hours in total on the whole. Like that's including like travel bookings and stuff as well, like just researching. Because there's also things like, you never know, there could be, like you find the most perfect location you want to go to for the portraits, and then there's a market on that day and you can't drive through and you definitely can't take any photos because there's 1,000 people milling around. So you got to make sure that this kind of thing doesn't happen either. So yeah, probably about 16 hours for destination weddings.
Is your pricing in the destination weddings reflective of all the pre-production time that takes place?
Yeah. Like all my pricing is based really, really strictly on my costs and the hours I spend on anything. So the destination wedding, it's a different package than my normal package. So I include the fact that I'm there a day early. I include like a separate portrait session, because I had this one wedding in a really beautiful location. And it's the usual thing. The ceremony is just before sunset. So you have like maybe 2 hours for the preparations. You maybe do a first look or something, and then it's the ceremony. And then the sun is set and you've taken maybe two rolls of portraits. in the resort hotel that looks like it could be anywhere. And then the next day, on your own, you spend driving around finding all these amazing places, and you think, I really wish that we could have had some time to take some portraits here. So now I include a portrait session the day before, the day after, just to make sure that we get the most out of the place. Because if people go and have a destination wedding, they like that place. Like, they want to see that place and not just the hotel. And they don't necessarily think of the fact that they don't have any time on the wedding day to take those pictures. So
that makes perfect sense. How do you charge your clients for your travel expenses?
So my travel expenses, I charge purely based on costs. But
do you mark it up at all?
I don't mark it up, because to me, that's one of those things about being upfront with my clients as well. Because usually the travel is probably the heftiest price tag almost. Like, I mean, obviously the package, it kind of depends, but it's definitely always more than they think they will spend on the travel, because you have to take everything into account. It's not just the flights and a hotel, it's the ground transportation, it's taxis, it's a rental car, and it's fuel. It's visas that you have to get, like entry visas. It's food on the wedding day. It's food the day before, stuff like that. If you take an assistant with you, you got to pay for that person.
Do you normally
as well.
Take an assistant with you?
It kind of depends on how far away it is and how big the wedding is, or how safe it is to travel there, rather. So I normally work on my own.
Safe?
Yeah.
You've shot at some dicey destinations?
Well, not like super dicey, but like places where you don't really know what's going to happen, and you don't know if you can take your gear into that place or not. Uh-huh. If you show up with a massive backpack and people are going to be like, what's happening here? So, like, I had this wedding in Myanmar, used to be Burma, and I couldn't...
It'll
like,
always be Burma to me.
Like, yeah. So the domestic flights I had to take, on none of the airline web pages could I find out how much luggage you can take. Like, it just did not give any information. It was just like, book this flight here and then just show up. So I had no idea. And I get to the airport and there's this massive sign of definitely no professional photography gear allowed.
Oh, wow.
Like, once I got there. So I was really glad I had my friend with me as my assistant, because I'm like, you take this bit and I take this bit. I mean, nobody said anything at the time, but it was like, I didn't know and I couldn't find out beforehand. And it was just good to have someone else there with you to kind of, you know, if you have to get like on a bus for 12 hours to get to the place or something. So in those situations, I always take somebody.
What's the most interesting place that you've shot?
That will probably be Myanmar at this point.
Okay.
Yeah.
And was that the scariest, or has there been like one that was like, you got off the plane, you're like, what did I get myself into?
Actually, it wasn't so bad because the people were amazingly friendly there. So they have like a lot of like military police and everything. I don't know if you know a lot about Burma, like it wasn't open for tourism until like 5 years ago. So, there's still big military police presence, which didn't help because the hotel we stayed in, they had like a marathon the next day, and the Thailand princess, the princess of Thailand, was running the marathon and staying at our hotel. So there was like
security everywhere.
Yeah, everywhere. So, but even those guys, they look pretty tough, but then you smile at them and they always smile back and they're like, just like these really happy, smiley people. So it wasn't really dicey once you got there. It was just beforehand, you just couldn't find out a lot about what's it going to be like. So it's just being, it's coming back to like being prepared and not really knowing what's going to happen, but in the end it was totally fine. So
how did we start working together? How did you find our lab? Because you're all the way in Europe, and it always fascinates me, because there's nothing that I do in my personal life where I would order something for, I would get a service done in Europe. So I always find it amazing that people send film from as far away as like New Zealand, Europe, and all these cool places.
So we don't have that many great labs in Europe. So there's a handful, and they're not bad, but I tried every single lab I could find, from the local shop down the road, which was horrific. Everything was very green when it came back, and he did not know what I meant when I said, can we adjust this? No, we cannot adjust this.
Oh,
so
wow.
I tried every single lab in Europe, and I didn't like what came back. And then I tried a few more labs all over the place, and it was okay. And then I'm like, I may just try these guys, why not?
Oh,
I think
so
actually recommended you as well.
So we were last?
You were, well, only because I stopped.
Okay.
Otherwise, obviously, you wouldn't have been last.
Okay.
So it's a good thing.
Yeah, okay. All right.
So,
first in your heart, last you try. That's fine.
It's not a bad thing.
So what was the difference?
You were just the best. It's literally true. And especially with things like, you know, when you go to a place where you don't know if the photos are going to turn out, or if it's all going to be fine because you traveled all over the place with those rolls and you had them in 90% humidity and, you know, like you never know what's going to happen with it. I just want somebody who I know I can trust to make them look as good as they possibly can. And that's what you do. I mean, you can pay me after that.
Yeah, the check's in the mail. Yeah. Does anybody have any questions? What would be your top three tips for any of these photographers here that would like to start shooting destination weddings or offer them in their packages?
So I think the number one thing would be, why do you want to do destination weddings? Because obviously, like, everybody loves to travel and it sounds really exotic and fun and all that kind of thing, but it's harder to shoot destination weddings because it is hard to travel with all your stuff. It is hard to be on a plane for all this time and then having to work a 15-hour day in the heat after that. And it's also harder to get your clients to understand that they should pay twice the price because they're flying you from all over the world when there could be someone else who's maybe almost as good as you locally. So you have to know why you want to do this in order to convince them that you are the right choice for it, I think. And also to make it worthwhile for yourself. Like, if you jet-lagged, waking up at 2 a.m., can't go back to sleep, and you know you have to start work at 8 a.m., you're like, why am I doing this again? So you need to know why. Otherwise, that's no fun.
That's called last night.
Yeah.
Okay, exactly. So that's one. What couple more tips.
Other than that, it's basically being prepared for everything. Like, it's really the number one thing. If you're not willing to put that much effort into it, then it's probably not gonna work out so well. Because if you just want to show up and shoot a wedding and have a really cool time, then that's not going to be the right thing for you, because it's not like being on holiday. It's really not. And everyone else there is on holiday and having a great time at their friend's wedding, and you're like, oh, I'm a little bit jealous now because I want to hang out at the tiki bar and grab a cocktail, yeah, but I can't because I'm working.
How do you navigate the travel fees with the client?
Bringing it up with the client. So I definitely have it in my pricing brochure that I send out the very first thing. It's in my brochure. It says that travel fees are always on top and kind of depending on the destination. And I give like a broad range. Like, if it's a European wedding, it's this much. If it's a worldwide wedding, it's this much. And that I need all travel expenses to be paid. For example, flights, accommodations for 3 nights. If an assistant is coming, they need to be paid as well. That's all listed in my brochure, so they already know about this. And even in the first email that I send back to them, I have like a small, like a little section, like a couple of lines where I say pricing, blah, blah, blah. Travel costs will always be charged on top and kind of depending on what time we're able to book anything. And then I bring it up again when I first talk to them. So I mention it all the time so that they already know about it. And it's not like a big shock where they're like, oh, yeah, we're totally ready to book. And I'm like, yeah, it's twice as much. And they're like, oh. So I bring it up all the time so it's not a bad shock. So they already get used to the idea of having to pay it.
How do you find those referrals for destination weddings as opposed to when it's local?
So number one is being featured on international blogs or magazines. So it was only when I started going from UK blogs only to like international blogs, like American blogs or whatever, that I got more inquiries. Like, places like Junebug are great for international inquiries. And then it's Google, obviously, so, and word of mouth. So a lot of people, like, a lot of my clients, if they have a destination wedding, a lot of their friends are coming from all over the place as well. Like, I have weddings where the people, they live in New York and they're getting married in France, but all their friends are coming from China or something like that. It's just like very international. So that kind of helps as well, because the people see me at the wedding and they love the pictures, and they might be getting married somewhere completely different, and then they will inquire as well. So that definitely helps. And with the Google thing, I think like everybody can put their name and then international wedding photographer next to it, and a lot of people do. But again, I think it's showing on your website that you do shoot internationally, and like showing all the different places you have been, again, to prove like that you can do this, to show people, yeah, I've done this, don't worry about it, I know what I'm doing.
Would you say a lot of the your business is referral based for the destination weddings?
For the destination weddings, I want to say it's probably 50-50.
That's great.
So it's always kind of changing. I find it really weird. Over the last few years, like, it used to almost all be from wedding blogs. Like, being featured on wedding blogs used to be my number one, like, kind of source for inquiries, and now it's probably dropped down to like 40%, and the rest is all Google and referrals. So Google has definitely risen when it comes to that, and then referrals is a big part still as well.
Okay, how do you navigate the visa situations traveling to other countries?
Thank you. It really depends on the situation, and most of the time it actually depends more on where your client is from, because a lot of the times it's, for example, it's people from England who are getting married somewhere else, so I don't need a visa for this because my client is in the UK, so I'm being booked in the UK, I'm being paid in the UK, and I'm just doing the work somewhere else. When it comes to, like, generally, you need to do your research, like, you need to look it up really, really carefully beforehand. Like, do I need anything? Do I need a visa to get to that country? Does my passport need to be valid for more than 6 months, for example, to get into that country? What are the general custom regulations, like flying with professional gear or something like that, in order to get there? So you need to look that up beforehand really, really carefully, because that's probably pretty bad if you show up at the immigration thing and they say, no, you can't come in because you're, I don't know, you don't have the visa that you should have gotten 3 months ago or something.
Do you always travel back home with the film and then ship the film from home over to us in the States, or are you shipping from the actual place where you shot the wedding?
I try to ship it as soon as I can. So depending on where the wedding is, and if I'm staying longer or not, it's just a safety thing for me. Like, I don't want to drag the film with me through more scanners, x-ray machines, whatever. I don't want to have it with me at a beach hut somewhere where it's rolling around in the sand.
Sure.
Not that I hang out at beach huts all the time after weddings, but
only
I like
occasionally.
To. Yeah,
sure.
I like to. So I try to ship it as soon as I can. And so for that, I usually it's bigger airports like Singapore or Hong Kong or something. They will always have like a business center with a FedEx office or something like that where you can send it from. So I take all the packaging with me. I usually print out an order form beforehand, or sometimes you get horribly scribbled things on like exotic hotel things from
sure.
me where it's like, oh, Anne, again.
No, but it's so, fun seeing the different letterhead from different resort hotels around the world. So it's entertaining for us.
But yeah, I try to ship it as soon as I can just so I know that it will get to the lab before anything else can happen to it. And generally, I always ship it with FedEx 24 hours because it's just, even if it's twice as much to send it like that or whatever, but it's just, I've made really, really good experiences with them. Like, it's tracked all the time. It's going to arrive safe. It's not going to lie in some warehouse over the weekend where I don't know what's going to happen to it.
Sure.
So just make sure you've got a courier company that you can trust and that you've used before, and you will mainly find them all over the place.
Do you have a business account set up with like FedEx?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's helpful with your rate, correct?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So if you could go back in time, what's one thing you wish you knew when you started as a photographer that you didn't know then that you know now?
Oh, I guess actually that would be how physically demanding it is to drag around cameras with you for 12 hours on a day. Because I've got a really bad back. From photography.
And we made it better by sitting here, right?
By sitting on this thing. So it's just, the log.
The log.
It's just, trying and stay fit, basically, and knowing that you should probably work on your upper body strength rather than chilling out in the winter months.
Do you do anything for that? Like Pilates or stretching or anything?
I do yoga, mainly. Uh-huh. Like, I do yoga every day and my chaturangas are on point. So
here's like the really, really deep question. The one that makes people cry. No, I'm just joking. But where do you see yourself in 5 years?
5 years, I would probably still be shooting weddings, but I definitely would not be forever shooting weddings, mainly because I think it's too hard on you physically, actually. And I don't want to be that old person at the wedding where everybody's like, who's that grandma over there dragging a camera around, because people are getting so young now who are getting married, or maybe it's just me. I don't know.
I think it's common
but,
that photographers
I definitely want to still be shooting weddings, probably a bit less and a bit more select, even though I think I'm on the right path to like having great clients, great people. I can't really complain about the kind of weddings that I get and the people that I get. So if it stays like this, it wouldn't be so bad.
What do you want to shoot other than weddings?
I just really enjoy doing portraits. Like, I really, really love doing portraits. I do a lot of like kind of like lifestyle sessions all over the place as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I quite like that because it gives you a bit more time to spend with the people and to kind of like explore different places as well. So
how many portrait sessions would you say you do on a given year or in a given year?
So generally probably around 20, and then about half of them are like those kind of like more location-based portrait sessions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Braden asks, what is the biggest lesson you've learned?
Like based on destination kind of weddings or generally? So number one is actually, since this is also related to RPL, if you send your film, always put it in a box. And I think you told me this before
bad
thing happened. Put it in an actual box. Don't put it in an envelope because
yes.
envelopes will rip.
Never
turns out.
Send your film
Never send
in
it in
envelope.
An envelope. So now I'm really, really hardcore about all my packaging the film before I send it to the lab. It's in 100,000 Ziploc bags labeled with how many rolls are in each bag. Bag 4 of 15 contains 18 rolls. And a little note to the customs people to please be kind to it.
And
it's always in a box.
We would rather spend 20 minutes opening your packaging than trying to figure out why the roll count is off and if the bag accidentally opened on the way there. So,
yeah, because I once had a not so nice call from you that shocked me.
But yours was the FedEx one that split in two, right? That was a good story.
No, it ripped, like the envelope ripped open and half of the film was missing when it got to you. And you were like, you said this is going to be whatever, 40 rolls and it's only 20. And I'm like, oh, that's great. I'm going to call you back. And then I had to like breathe really deeply and trying to figure out what happened. And I think it actually arrived a day later.
Yeah. So there's two good things about that story. Obviously not the fact that only half the rolls arrived. I actually went in the dumpster to make sure that we didn't accidentally throw away the 20 rolls. So the t-shirt I was wearing that day was ruined. But the second best part is that FedEx found it, and the next day the rest of the film showed up. So yeah. It ended well. We only freaked her out for about 16 hours.
That's cool. It was the night before a wedding as well. It's great. I was just at the pub with my pint. I'm like,
oh, man.
Yeah, that was probably the number one lesson that I've learned.
Yeah, no, we haven't gotten a mailer from her since. It's all been boxes. So
yeah, I always hand deliver now.
Yeah.